And here we go. So welcome back. This time I'm going to trust technology and don't wait for the chat to confirm that my audio is coming. So yeah, welcome back. This new episode, probably the season finale for this season, what is it, three? Probably we will have, I will have another stream in the middle of this week. And I'm hoping, you know, I'm planning to have Marco. So just watch the YouTube so, you know, you can catch it. You know, my plan was to have Marco today, but it was not possible. So hopefully this week, in the middle of the week, around Wednesday, Thursday, something like that, we will have Marco. So stay tuned. So the 1.7 was released. And I think of what I can remember, I think this was easily the hardest release that we did. And the other day I was thinking how after we released the Japanese pack, me, Luca Sodano, Emmanuel, and you know, Simone, as soon as we released the pack, we went online and we started racing with the MX5 online, and it was a very relaxed release. This time around, everybody was really, really burned, and you know, and pretty much at 9 o'clock, as soon we started to see the first reports that, you know, people could actually drive all the cars, we all went to bed straight away, extremely burned. You know, nobody really went online to race. I think Manuel was racing yesterday. Personally, I didn't. I'm so burned this time that I just you know, need a little bit of rest. So yeah, it was a very, very tough release. Today we're going to do a little bit of coding, a little bit of talking about what my wishes are for 1.8, the next update of Assetto Corsa. You know, I get to do the wish list this time. And then to punish Marco that is not here, I'm going to show you something that, you know, we never shown before. And, you know, even if he gets angry, well, suck it, you should be here and you're not. So I'm going to show something new. Let's start as usual with the questions from the last stream. So Jim Liak is asking, is the Q standing for quality connection going to return? If you notice, the Q disappeared from the screen. There is a, when you're racing multiplayer, on the top right of the screen, there is a two elements that there used to be, Q and P. P is the ping and it's telling you what your ping is. Q is the quality of the connection. And the reason why it's gone is because the new server has a new experimental feature that is something that I call bandwidth optimizer. It's not really anything, you know, science fiction. It's simply that the server is saving some bandwidth by sending the packets to the different cars related to how far they are from each other. So in other words, if you are not receiving all the packets from all the cars all the time, but you're only receiving all the packets from the five cars that are closer to you, and then you start to get one every two from the other cars and so on and so on. So that is actually able to put the bandwidth for a full server of 25, you know, it cuts in half the bandwidth that is required from the server to run a full race. The downside of that is that now the client is not able anymore to bet on the fact that it will receive a certain amount of packet from every driver. So that's what it was used to calculate the queue. So if I put back the queue, it will not be, it will always show, like, you know, a very low value if the server has the bandwidth optimizer enabled. So I will have to come up with a different strategy for the queue. So probably eventually, yes, I want to put it back. I just need to understand how to do this. Probably I will do the opposite. Instead of counting on the client, I will count on the server. The server always receives a certain amount of packets from every client, so the server can work out the quality of the connection and then send it back to the client saying, well, this is your queue, exactly like the server is doing with the ping. The server is telling the client, this is your ping. German Ban is asking, is the implementation of manual engine stars planned sometimes in the future, or do you think you won't be implementing it at all? Well, if you watched last stream, you saw that as far as the code part is concerned, is already there. I can simply enable it, just putting the variables to true. The problem there is really the audio, because you know we need, well, there are two problems. One problem is the audio. So we will have to, you know, we will have to go and gather starting noise, starting audio for 100 plus cars. And, you know, because we are also doing new cars, and so Luca and the other guy that is working with him, they are very busy creating the new cars. They really don't have the time to go around and do this starting noise. So that's one reason. The other reason is that, of course, you get in all kind of situations where some cars don't have an onboard starter, like an F1, for example. So if you stall it, that's it. You remain there. So and so we need to account for that. So I don't know. Even if the functionality is there, I don't see it happening very, very soon. Trin Channel is asking me a question in Italian. He's asking me why I use Blender. He spot here the icons of Blender, and just give a quick answer to him in Italian. Non lo uso. Lo uso per fare esperimenti con Unreal Engine, quindi ci creo cubi e sfere, cose del genere, quindi niente di serio. And so the answer was basically I don't really use it. I just use it for creating cubes and spheres and so on to then test stuff either in a real engine on or in Assetto Corsa. So it's not really something that I use very much. Splendid Truth is saying that he watched the AI drive on board and it looks like they never use partial throttle. It's either on or off. Also, cars cannot opposite lock, so at the exit of turns, if they have to oversteer even a little bit, they don't use opposite lock like we do. Instead, the AI brake to stop that drift and brakes more if it needs to. Well, it's true that the AI drives a little bit on-off. It's not really true that it's not using partial gas. Now, probably he didn't look at this one. Let's have a look how the AI is driving this car. I hope you can see the gas pedal here. So it's full pedal, full gas here, of course, and then it's braking. As you can see, you know, now is half a gas and then it's giving gas and then it's oversteering. So it really depends on the car. There are cars that definitely the AI sort of understand if it's driving a car that wants to be driven with oversteer, or if it's driving a car that needs a more clean drive. What he was saying is sort of true, not completely true. As you can see, the AI is going to oversteer. Actually, the problem here is that the AI is too good at this. So I have been trying for, you know, since I started to work on Assetto Corsa to find a way to have the AI making mistakes when accelerating. and I couldn't find one because, you know, they are so good in reacting instantly, and, you know, with the steering wheel, that, you know, they hardly get into a situation where they can lose the car. It just doesn't happen. And, you know, they in for this, they are just using, I think, stability control, but it's mostly a security thing. I don't really think it influenced that much. The driving. Let's try, because you know that on these streams I'm not scared of doing something stupid. Let's try to turn the stability control off for the artificial intelligence. Let's see if they can drive. Probably, you know, there will be situations and combos where, because I remember turning this on and off all the time, and eventually I stumbled on a particular combo of truck and car that, you know, seems to need stability control. Because actually, this could be a good way to have them making mistakes. You know, I could just turn the two ways that I've been trying are, actually, this is one way that I never tried before, but the other way is to add some lag to the steering wheel reaction. Especially, I was trying to do that especially as a response to contacts between cars. The eye always look extremely strong when you hit them, and the reason is not really that they have more grip or something like that. The reason is that they react instantly to the collision, and so, you know, let's see if he's able to drive without the stability control. It actually is putting the car much more sideways. That's very interesting. Oh, look at that. That's very interesting. That's really, really cool. Really interesting. Look at that. That's awesome. Oh, I never seen this. Let's see if it's going out here. This is always a little bit tricky for the eye. They go out. Unbelievable. Well, this is really opening a lot of possibilities. You know, because even adding them, because I think it's lower, you know, it's using too much oversteer. But it would be cool to have, you know, one or two of them, you know, making mistakes every once in a while. And let's see if it's going out in this one. Ah, this is super cool. Look at that. Totally awesome. I made an AI that can participate to drifting competitions. So to go back to the question, school, in this, you know, this is one of the first time in the stream that we really see something happening that is opening the door for something in the future. You know, just have this stability control gain vary a time, and we might have AI coming out like that from the corner. Very cool. Okay, so Adrian Stealth, cool name. Is it possible to turn off all those red triangles floating in the air and everything else in the air too? Well, he's talking about the triangle, which is called the proximity indicator. And the answer to the question is yes. What you do is you go into the folder where you have Assetto Corsa, and then you go into System, CFG, and then you find a file called proximity indicator, and in this file you set this height to 1 and they're gone. So yeah, you can do that. Speedy Beef is asking Marco and Stefano. He was expecting Marco to be here. Can you describe your typical working day? Is it any day typical? And then he asked lots of questions for Marco that I will give to him next time we do a stream. And my day is pretty much always the same, regardless of weekends and things like that. I tend to get really involved in my work, so I usually wake up very, very early, around 6:30, 7, something like that, and I get to work. I check the forums in the morning, but usually in the morning I'm usually writing a lot of code in the morning, so that's really the time for me to get stuff done. And you can also see it from today that, you know, I woke up and I started to work on our friend here, the Oculus Rift, and there were problems with the post-processing, and I spent like a couple of days last week before the release, this week before the release, and I wasn't able to manage to understand why the image was blurred. Then I figured it out this morning, and I got so excited that I wanted to release straight away, and sadly that also came with a bug on the strut suspension. So sorry about that. You know, that's sometimes I feel like sometimes we abuse a little bit of the possibility that Steam give us to do updates anytime we want. And you know, the advantage of that approach is that you know, you don't have to wait a long time for fixes like this to appear. The downside of that is that sometimes you screw it up and make mistakes, and stuff that shouldn't be online goes online with bugs. And yeah, sorry about that. So yeah, so nothing really exciting among my job. You know, I usually have really very definite cycles in my life, and where I go back and forth between obsessing on work and programming, or obsessing on playing guitar. So it's like I either do for the entire day this one of these two things, and when I get obsessed about developing a programming, like, you know, in this period, usually it's like, you know, 12 hours a day. I mean, I literally don't do anything else. You know, if I go out, I go out to buy food and stop to have lunch, watching some random episode of South Park. South Park for me is a little bit like the Bible for religious people. You know, they say, like, you know, you open the Bible and God talk to you. You know, me, I open South Park and South Park talk to me. So i7 fan is asking, Stefano, please, when you have time to do something about the multiplayer where people can stand still on the track forever and nothing happens. Yeah, I think it's reasonable. It's reasonable and quite easy to do something like that. It's a little bit tricky to understand if they are in the pit lane or not, but you know, it should be easy. Warlock is asking about the AI line. Basically, he's asking if it is possible to have multiple AI lines. And the answer is that I tried a couple of times. The problem is that it becomes a little bit difficult because the AI is using the spline to understand if it's got a car in front or on a side. It's not really using real positions, because you can imagine if you are in a corner, you know, you might think that you have a car on the side of you, but actually it's on the other side of the corner. So it's important that they all agree on what the ideal line is. I would like that, but you know, if you've seen in the new version, in 1.7, you know, they do spread out a little bit, especially on the straights. And they tend to reconverge to the same line in the corners. Then Yoman is asking about aggression settings for the eye. The interesting thing about his questions is to differentiate open wheel racing versus touring car racing. And it's something that I thought more than one time that, you know, AI should have a different approach in and that basically translates into how much distance the AI is giving on a side. So I was thinking that probably the AI should have a, you know, the car, every car should have a, an indication of how far you want to be, you know, if you have to be very cautious with that car or not. So if you have a touring car, you can be a bit more close to the opponent, because even if you, you know, scrub a little bit, nothing happened. But of course, for with open wheels, not only you have the tires, but you know, you have the problem that, you know, you can get stuck between the two cars can get stuck. So it's an interesting idea for the future. So let's move on quickly to one bug that I want to sort out today, if I can, or at least understand what's going on. And what's going on here is that the 250 car, the Maserati, really doesn't start well. They're very slow when they start, so let's try to understand what's going on and why they're so slow. Interesting. What I think is happening is that he's sitting the damage probably. Let's see. Well, first of all, he is putting the second gear in too quickly. So it is okay with the engine, and then I think it's going to give it full rev, bang. It's gonna be tricky. It's definitely not doing any stupid braking or anything like that. It's just one thing that might be happening here is that to start, the eye is using the limiter, So what the code is doing here, it looks like is doing, is putting it exactly at the same RPM to change, and then is accelerating to the maximum. A little bit before start. Which not totally sure it's the right thing to do. Let's try just to, as an experiment, take this one off and let's see if it gets better. little bit better, but still bad. Try if like this, they're still too slow. Yeah, they are still very slow. I can basically pass a lot of them. It's very tricky. Because I think what is going on here is that they are hitting the damage, and now there is a new code. Because this car doesn't have a rev limiter. I mean, it's got a rev limiter, but the rev limiter is coming after the time where the car is taking damage. I think what is happening is that I think the only way to fix this is to let them start with the clutch. I think what is happening is two things. One thing is that, the other thing is that the changing gears takes so long that the engine goes down with the RPM. I must have a code. To close the gas when it's changing gears. Oh, this is interesting. So, use 3-star flag. Okay. So, this is the guy that is turning our gas off. So, let's say that it doesn't do that. We cannot do that. We cannot say that we shouldn't do that. Actually, there is this restart flag here. So I think this code is not called. Well, I think this is going to be tricky. I think we should check here if if we're not too close to the damage. Here we're still in the then we go here. Is putting that gas to zero, and I don't understand what it is. So it definitely looks like it's the damage. So. Okay. So in theory, we just need to release the gas a little bit. That it gets cold. that was something else, because that was something else, because the second I can see here, that was the code for the damage, but the first one was still going to zero. But it was not that code that made the car stay. So there is something else. It could be the limiter itself. This is the damage, this is the second series. The first series is something else that it's... Let's try something else. Let's try to have the eye changing gear first. So we put down this value. Don't understand why it doesn't change gear. That's what I don't understand. Oh well, I think I will have to work on this. It's not that easy. Not something that can be done on a Sunday afternoon. Sadly. It's much more complicated than I thought. The frequency of that looks... So where is my change up? Shit. Where is my change up? So here's my gear. So here, the
guys full gas. So that is happening before. Before changing up. That's happening before changing up. So probably is in the reaction time. Still happening, restart. So there is something else that is setting the controls to zero. Be exactly this one here. Let's try to keep it. Let's try to, instead of floor it like an idiot, let's try to keep it slightly above. That's good. Okay. So let's try to start with them. Still damage a little bit the engine, but okay. I'll leave with that.
Awful start.
What an idiot. What an idiot.
Still a little bit lazy at a certain point, but I can get a couple of positions, but that's pretty much it.
Okay. Now, of course, I should try to see if this is breaking other cars starting. Let's see. That's always the problem.
This car, for example, you know, we start the limiter. No, that's good. Could be a fix, hopefully. All right, so let's move on to next thing, which is, you know, what I would like to happen for 1.8. You know, my desire is that at the moment I don't think we have cars that will require a lot of dedicated work like what happened with the Ferrari SF15. So my wish is to work more on the racing features, and finally I hope to see these custom championships coming. You know, they will be really great. Also have the possibility to have an aggression slider on the AI. I would also like to do some experimental work on the blue flag, try to understand if it is reasonable to put a setting where you have a certain amount of time that you can be shown a blue flag, and then, you know, you need to get out of the way. So if you have shown a blue flag for a certain amount of time, you get either a penalty or whatever kind of penalty the system require, the system the server will choose. On the single player side, it would be nice if the artificial intelligence will understand. I would like the artificial intelligence to understand two things. One is blue flag. The other one is very similar to that, is understanding that you know, your car cannot really compete with the car that is coming. So in other words, try to see if I can manage to FDI sort of getting out of the way and making make a pass easier, which could be as simple as, you know, as soon DI gets on a straight and realize that there is a faster car behind, you know, it will move out from the line. There's something, you know, I need to look into it, because I really don't know what's actually the best way, you know, to do it, if it is to get out from the line or to stay on the line and sort of slow down a little bit, so the other car can pass more quickly. So those are two things that are definitely, I will definitely look into it. The other thing that I already did some work yesterday is trying to do a very aggressive optimizing work on the physics in general, and see if we can up the frequency of the physic engine to 500 hertz, and that will allow us to run a bit more aggressive on the dampers and avoid all those situations where the cars are vibrating or exploding and things like that when the damper are too high. Probably also a different way to express fast bump settings, because at the moment fast bump setting is sort of an absolute value. I don't know if it makes sense to have it as a different in slope compared to what the slow is. I'm also reading some papers on simulating the damper response, so get away from a simple, you know, 2-point line, 3-point line where you have the slow, the threshold point, and then the fast. And also the other thing that I spoke with Aris is the possibility to have lookup tables for dampers. And lookup table for dampers, the code is very easy. It becomes difficult when it comes to try to do setups, because you lose the four way. You know, you can have a situation where you have a two way settings where you can set bump and rebound. So you just set a different lookup table for each settings that you have. Of course, you know, you will not be able to set up your fast. Well, you could, but at that point your number of lookup tables will explode into many, because it becomes you have to work out all the combinations, which is a little bit more time consuming. So, but I think it's a nice feature to have in parallel to the one that we have at the moment. And definitely I would like a more race-oriented update instead of a, if you want, physics-oriented update. Okay, so to close, before we go to the Q&A session, I promised I will show you something that we never showed before, and here we go. So, yeah, we go for a lap on the Superelevata. And I also explain why this track is not in Assetto Corsa yet, although we work it out, because this is part of the console version of Assetto Corsa, so it's already working over there. No, I put the race. Let me stop this. I didn't intend to do this. What I want is a practice with one car. This is a very particular track, and sort of requires a sort of tricky approach on timing, because the way it works is that you come out from the pits in here, and then you go on the Superelevata. You see on the left, we close the track, and that's the one that is going to the other side. So you go on the sopraelevata here, which is an experience all to itself. Quite scary. I should have increased my ratio. I don't have enough ratio to go faster. I don't want to blow my engine. So this is the second one. We already had a couple of races a couple of months ago, I think, as devs in multiplayer on this one. It's mental, it's totally mental. Okay, so you see that now we are on the other side of the track. So, in other words, you do one lap on that side and then one lap on this track. So now we're back on this track and we do the track that we have already. In Assetto Corsa. Steering wheel going. The steering wheel is majorly broken. It through this lap. So let's move on. I'm not really fond of this track. I've never been, even in Grand Prix Legends. I don't know why. I know Marco spent, like, you know, ages on this track in Grand Prix Legends. This corner I always hated. I never understand how. I don't see it and really don't understand how to take it properly. You can really see, but this track is very representative of the era. You really see that these cars are made for this kind of tracks. So not really for the not really for the tracks that we have right now with lots of corners, things like that, you know. It's definitely a different era. So now we are back on this part of the track, and now is where the lap starts. So in other words, the timing needs to work out this thing, and then you need to go through two laps. Actually, it's not even that. I need to do another lap. This is something that is going always gonna it cut a lot of the testers for the console version out, you know, because they thought this is a bug. Actually, because the finish line is on the other side of the track, so you need to go around this again, and then you start a lap. So it takes ages before you can actually do a lap. Very bumpy here. And flat out. Oh, this is scary. I'm a bit understood. It's really scary. As it's jumping all over the place. Let's see if finally the lap time starts. Yes, finally we got our lap time. So there you go. That's going to be an interesting thing to have. I don't know if it's going to be in 1.1. It's sorry, 1.8. But it's pretty much ready, so I would suppose so. Okay, so that's it for this stream. Let's go to the question and answer that you might have. So let's start. So Tobias is asking, can you tell us about the regulation on the damage model from the manufacturer for a car Can you tell us about the regulation on damage model from a manufacturer for a car you want in AC? I think he's asking if the manufacturer asks us not to damage the cars, and the reason and the answer is no. Then nobody asks us anything about that. People having a laugh at my steering wheel that almost wanted to jump off the table. Mike Evans is saying that, you know, the Rift is good in AC but still waiting for a better UI, and you know, it's not gonna happen, sorry. You know, this is what we have at the moment and we need to work with it. Stefano, is it possible to implement the delta up to circle the reference? Best session, best option. I don't understand the question that he was trying, and the chat went away from me. Is it possible? So is it possible to implement the delta up to cycle the reference? Ah, you mean the okay. Okay. Yeah, why not? We don't have an optimal absolute lap saved, but you know, could be an interesting. The energy recovery system recharge rate in the P1 is faulty. Yes, Aris is going to look into that this week. My wife is watching with me, and it will make her day if you say happy birthday, Amanda Hudson. Happy birthday, Amanda Hudson. Mike is still saying, you know, you still need to take the Rift on and off with the C. Yes, that's the case. It's not going to change. You know, as you know, the launcher in Assetto Corsa is just an HTML application, so there is no way that we're going to make that work with Rift. So you have to treat Rift as a bit like your helmet. So you choose what you want to do, then you go race, put your helmet, and off you go. Pavel is asking about AI in multiplayer. Sorry, it's not possible. Stefano, does Aris try to beat the special event? No, Aris is not working on the special events at all. I think it's one of those parts of Assetto Corsa that really doesn't come into my world or Aris' world at all. It's just other guys working on those. So I don't know. I you know, probably they're too difficult. I have no idea, because me neither. I never tried them. So Jonathan, view why 488 GT3 before the GTB. I don't know. I think you would people will ask exactly the same question and the opposite if the GTB came out first. So there is no licensing. The GTB is also pretty much ready to be released. So we'll see. Asking about pit limiter and stall. I think I just talked about stalling. Come on, guys. Pit limiter, I don't know. Definitely I want, I think I said on the last stream, I want to put a penalty for entering into the pit lane too fast. So Stefano, there will be an update for the all-wheel drive physics. I think the update is going to be that all the cars that have that kind of system will move to the similar system that we have with the Aventador. So eventually Aris will do that. Marco is asking if there's going to be DirectX 12 in AC, and the answer is no. At the moment, there is no possibility to do that at all. And You know, I don't see the advantage. You know, if I had to start the game right now, I would use that. It takes 12, but adding another API to Assetto Corsa at the moment, I don't think it's going to bring anything interesting. Grande Punto is asking if I get to drive all the cars in AC. Not as much. I mean, there are. I think, like everybody, you know, I have three or four cars that I tend to levitate to every time I test something and I work on something. And of course, if there is a bug on some particular car, I will use it. And sometimes it's interesting when we do the rounds to balance the force feedback. And yeah, I get to discover a lot of car that I never use and I don't know why. Just before release, one of our graphic guy signaled me a problem that wasn't there with the Alfa Romeo 155 at Monza. And, you know, I got to have a fantastic race. I just he said that there was a problem at the first corner on the T1 at the starting. So I said, okay, let's try, let's see. So I did, I started this race with 20 155 at Monza, and I ended up doing 7 laps in the race because I had too much fun. Irul is asking how much of the code of the energy recovery system of the SF15 can be reused for the upcoming Porsche. I don't know. I don't know because I don't know what the Porsche is doing. I'm totally ignorant when it comes to Porsche. You just, you know, all I know is that they have lots of nines in the names, but that's all I know about Porsche. I think the only Porsche that I like is the Porsche that the girl in Top Gun is driving. And I remember I went to a Porsche museum in Stuttgart many years ago, and they had that car, and that was cool. That was a cool car. Everything else, I don't know. So we will see if it is. The code that we have is very Formula One oriented, so we will have to see if when it comes a different car that has a slightly different system, if it's easier to just build another one completely dedicated to that car, or try to add whatever differences in the code that we have right now. But I would say that probably in the future, Aris definitely has more work than me to do for balancing. And is saying something, I lost it. Cranky say something about first the lap count is confusing. I agree it's confusing. I need to look into it. I tried to do something new and then I reverted it the day before because I sort of changed my mind on it, and you know, I need to look into it again. Asking if the brake temperature are going to be added to the GT3 cars and when. Yes, but I have no idea when. For the LMP1 field, will you honor all the different year system from the different cars? Again, I don't know until I see which car I need to do, and then what kind of information we have available, because that's the other trick part. You know, it always depends on what information that you have. Max Sampler is saying the Alpha 75 V6 will be very cool. Yes, it will be very cool. I love that car. I totally love the Alpha 75. Absolutely. there will be more option to configure the force feedback in the game. No, I don't, as you know, I really don't like the fact that we have too many, for my taste, we have too many options already. So I think the force feedback should be right. And that's it. You know, you shouldn't have too much tweaking into it. Silicate Blur yesterday. I don't understand what they're saying. Stefano, would it be possible to look to implement some sort of power steering? Right now, our wheels are good on high speed feedback, actually stiff and also real on low speed situations. I don't know. You know, at the end, it's going to be. Why not? But I don't see it. You know, the problem is that we really don't have enough torque anyway in the steering wheel, so I don't know. Electro is asking if the 250 have the solid axle, and the answer is yes, it's got the solid axle. Is there a technical reason why soft locks isn't in the main UI? Well, yeah, because they suck. So I'm ashamed of them. So yeah, until they get better, I rather hide them so people don't discover how much they suck. Is D-pad support in the pipeline? I don't know. I would still like to do that thing I was saying some months ago about doing the pit stop using the D-pad. So we will see. It's part of what I would consider a good possibility for, you know, a racy oriented 1.8. Do I have a favorite car that is not in the game but you dream about putting it? Yes, the Ferrari 250 GTO. That one. Yeah. Absolutely. Pretty much a lot of old car. The one of my favorite cars is the Alfa Romeo. What was it? Was it this one? Not this one. I always forget how it's called. Well, next time. It's an old Alfa Romeo from the 30s. Something like that. Not that. If it was for me, really, if I had absolutely no need to sell games in order to pay my rent, I will do a game entirely on cars from the 30s. So. Leonardo is asking if the console version will be 1.8 when released, or they will have separate build numbers. They will have separate build numbers and probably will lag behind the PC version for 3 or 4 months probably. Releasing on the console is not really like releasing on the PC. For example, the PS4 version that will go on the disc, it's already gone. You know, we are already working on whatever is coming as either day one patch or updates after that. So that one is already gone. So it's and because of stability, it's quite, compared to the PC, it's quite behind. A general question: was the beginning of Assetto Corsa and Kunos Simulazioni a tricky time in my life? Kunos Simulazioni comes way before Assetto Corsa, because Kunos Simulazioni is 2005, and yes, it was big change because I moved from Tokyo to a mountain in Italy near Trieste, so that was a pretty extreme change in lifestyle. So tricky from that point of view, yes. Assetto Corsa, the beginning of Assetto Corsa was difficult because we really didn't have much budget to work with, if none. So yeah, it was difficult. What about Vulkan API support in the next game? Whenever time will come, you know, to do a next game, yes, I think I will look into DirectX 12 and Vulkan and see what is what and see which one I feel more comfortable. Yeah. I don't know about the Alfa Giulia. The car is beautiful. You know, the car is beautiful and really belongs to Assetto Corsa. Whether or not Marco is able to get it, I don't know. But you know, I think everybody will agree that, you know, the car belongs to Assetto Corsa, so I hope so. Yeah, V is saying that there are people that are interested in classic cars, but you know, our numbers tell us that it's not many. And Karim is Kazar, which I think is Mr. Beam, isn't he? Is saying that the X curve and the Y curve is not working with the new tire model. Yeah, I know, because we don't use it, so I didn't implement it yet. Sorry to ask again, I think you were looking, okay, do you have a purpose for simulating the tire radius as a function of tire angular velocity? Well, the purpose is because it's an effect that exists in reality. So, yeah, that's the only purpose, is try to model as much as possible from reality. When if the D-pad is implemented for pit stop, like you say, will it be remappable to other things? We will see. I don't know at the moment. You know, there is nothing more than what I have in my head. So we will see. You know, once we have the system, yes, there isn't a reason why it couldn't be used for other things other than putting the time to implement it. What is my favorite track? Not only AC track. I think I answer many times. Right now, I think when I see on YouTube, I think Portimao and Alton Park are the tracks there are more that, you know, I always enjoy looking at those on YouTube. Alton Park, I didn't buy it on iRacing yet, so I don't really know. You know, I remember an old version that we used in Netcar, but yeah, possible to possible to force AI road cars to use road tile only. Yeah, that would be nice. That would be really, really nice. I have no idea how to do that in the user interface, but yeah, that would be nice. That would be nice. You know, probably some sort of street legal check, and you know, and so the artificial intelligence is choosing. The problem is that we will have to put another value into the time model saying if that particular compound is tar illegal or not. Stefan, any chance of having AC display more than six clouds at once? Ben, I have no idea. You know, it's one of those questions that I think it does, they don't make sense, because if I put 10, you will ask if there is a chance to put more than 10. If I put 20, you will ask if there is a chance to put more than 20. So I don't know. Stefano, what are your numbers telling you on car usage? I don't have numbers really. I think we stopped with the statistics after probably the early access. So I don't know, but you know, if you can go with what it's used on the servers online, you know, it's easy to see that they are the vast majority of what is used in Assetto Corsa. And it's a shame, because you really have cars that are little gems and gets completely, you know, not looked into it, which is, for example, the C9. C9 is one of those cars that the problem with a car like a C9 is that it's so difficult that even me sometimes I sort of remember, oh my god, we have a C9 in Assetto Corsa. I try to drive it, and you know, yes, it's nice, but it's just asking a little bit too much, and so it can get frustrating. Asking about Aston Martin and Jaguar, if the Brexit could affect licensing. I don't think so. I don't think the Brexit affects licensing. No, I don't think so. Oh my god, I'm so behind actually. Asking if there will be a fix for flickering shadow a long distance. Unless I wake up with a, you know, stroke of genius, I don't think so, sadly. That's the best we I can do at the moment. So tough. Any chance for forward wheel drive? Let me think. I don't think we have anything coming in the future. It would be nice to have that car that we used to have in the free netcar version, the MG. What was it called? It was the BTCC car. Also, I remember that had a bug where the engine was producing twice as much torque, and it was literally impossible to drive. Stefano, the heave spring wrong length becomes really important when, it becomes really important when there are regular spring too. I absolutely agree with you. It's something that, you know, something that I should redesign, because it's not really as it is at the moment. You know, there is a preload into the third spring, but at the moment you can get into situation where you have one string pushing up and the other strings pushing down, which doesn't make sense at all. Uh, a guy in Italian and is saying that he will like cars from the beginning of the 80s. And yeah, my favorite Formula One year to do, it always been, I think it was the first thing that I did when I started, I wouldn't say working, I would say dreaming about doing racing simulation. And the first thing that I did was trying to do a game about the Formula One season of 1979. So that would be 1 year that, you know, that I would really love. There is one Ferrari that I love, which is the this one with Schechter and Villeneuve that won. I love this car, it's so unique. It's really unique. Really unique car. And we will see. And those years that there were the Renault Turbo, I think, was amazing. Asking if it would be possible to implement a launch control feature. Yes, I think it's becoming more important now that we are starting to remove the clutch from cars that don't have it in real life, like the Aventador, for example. So starting by slamming the first gear in is not really that realistic. So I think it could be interesting to have a launch control system. Isn't it like the worst Ferrari Formula One? No, it's actually this car is won the championship that year with Schechter, so definitely. And I think after that that one, I think the next one to win with Ferrari was Schumacher, so very important car. Yeah, is it the one, I'm not sure, is the one with Arnoux versus Villeneuve. I'm not totally sure that it was in that year. But yeah, you know, that would be another point for that car. Flanders Scarlet is asking, we will get more axles. No, definitely not. I know already you're talking about the Tyrrell, but no. Do you think the sort of AI that is present in Forza, he's talking about this technology called Drivatar, is the future of AI? To be honest with you, I don't know Forza, so you know, I don't have it, and I don't play with it, so I have no idea to what level of refinement they can get, so I have absolutely no idea. It's definitely a neat idea to have a centralized database where AI can store experience. If you watched my stream, my last stream, I was talking about the fact that I have this feeling that I have reached a point where it's difficult to move forward on the AI, especially on the from the point of view of making them faster than they are, and to do the next step you will need some sort of experience. So you will need the AI that will say, well, okay, so the automatic the algorithm that calculates how quickly I can go through this corner is telling me that I should be able to go through this corner at this speed, but you know, I know that I went last lap and I had, you know, absolutely no problem doing it, so probably I can do it a little bit faster. Something like that. It's a very dangerous is a very dangerous system to implement, because every time I tried, you always get these algorithms where the AI is trying to go a little bit faster every time to improve, and eventually they will go too fast and they will make a mistake. So you will have the AI going into this kind of loop where it's going faster, 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 and then it makes a mistake and it goes, oh, let me go back then. And then it goes faster, 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 and then a mistake and it goes back and so on. So complicated, complicated. For the AI, thoughts on having them spin out. If you watch the beginning of exactly this stream, I was exactly experimenting and showing that. So yeah. Asking about the workload with console release and so on. We have two developers that are full time on the console. And then, you know, myself, I sort of moving back and forth from the console to PC. So it's tough, it's very tough, it's too tough for us. Three project is very, very difficult. We have a new developer coming in, I think at the end of this month, beginning of next month. So we will see. Mike, he was saying, you know, the T5 was the worst car. Yes, it was not a very good car, the one after that. The T5. Gamer Muscle, Open VR for the Vive. Yes. Yes, I have to do that. Eventually, I will have to do that. What is my favorite mod in AC? I don't know. I don't really try mods. So I wouldn't know. Giuseppe Abagnale is asking, I would like to have details about the axle model. Is geometry will proper anti-dive feature simulated correctly? Why we can't set up packers? Well, yes, the anti-dive geometry should be simulated correctly. Packers, I'm not really sure that is something that is applied to solid axles. I mean, there is no reason other than the cars that we did. I mean, packers is really something that has to do with aerodynamic. You want a car that is soft in the corners, but then sit on the packers when you're going fast. And you know, if I cannot really think about a race car with solid axle and high downforce. Well, definitely none of the cars that we did with solid axle have downforce, so adding the packers had absolutely no reason at all for us. Albi's asking what could be the next big features added after the brake temps are completed. I don't know. At the moment, the physics, I would like, for me, the next thing that I see right now that I'm obsessed about it is getting the performance up so I can put the engine at 500 as originally we envision for Assetto Corsa. And it's a very difficult task because, you know, you need to be able to run the AI. So, and the AI is running your car. And right now, the algorithms for the AI are pretty heavy on the CPU. In fact, the AI is not running the algorithm on every step. is sort of cycling through them. So they are not running it at every step because it's too heavy at the moment. So that's the thing that I'm most obsessed at the moment. So probably I would imagine that Aris has got a lot of work to do with the brakes. So I think for a couple of months we will not see major changes on the physics side. What can you tell us about Lucas drifting? He's doing fine. I bet he's helping him with the work experience on AC. Well, the nice thing I think about all the experience that he's doing right now, you know, he's working as an instructor for drifting, and I think it's really a fantastic spot for sim racing, not for Assetto Corsa. Of course, Assetto Corsa in particular, because he works for Assetto Corsa, but Luca has been using simulators for a long, long time. And I think it's very interesting that both Luca and Aris will tell you that the simulators really gave them a lot of what they actually bring then on a real car. And I think it's amazing because it's also reflect my experience. I simply don't have the balls. I don't have the balls to get a Lamborghini Aventador, and you know, I didn't even have the balls to turn completely the traction control off. And but you know, when it comes to going in Vallelunga and braking at a certain place because you know that the simulator told you that you can break there, and you know, from that point of view, you know, I'm totally confident when I do it. So I'm not confident in my driving abilities when it comes to drifting, because also even in the game I did crash many times in Vallelunga, and I don't want to do the same with a real car. But when it comes to, you know, braking points, going on the gas and things like that, it's one thing that the simulator just gives you total confidence when you get on a real track. And those guys were really able to bring their experience that they had in the simulator in the real life. And I think it's a fantastic spot for the entire genre. Luca Benjamin, what they see different from a real simulator? I don't know. You have to define what a real simulator is, and you know. So once we understand what a real simulator is, you will have to go and look into the source code and understand what is the difference. But you know, I know that there are people that work on very high level simulations, and they, when they came to Vallelunga to try Assetto Corsa, and they looked what we were doing, for example, with things like blistering and graining, and Aris gave you the example of aerodynamic at high yaw angle of attacks and things like that. More than one of them told us, you know, why you even bother with this stuff? We don't even consider it. So, you know, I don't want to, you know, but I think that the typical sim racer, if is given the chance to try one of these high-end simulator, could be quite disappointed, but I will leave it there. Okay, what time it is? Okay, I think, guys, we're all pretty tired. I will thank you everybody for joining this, following this season. Again, we will probably say goodbye for this season until 1.8 starts to come a little bit closer. In theory, the plan is to be able to release 1.8 together with the release on the console that should be at the end of August. So again, not very far, not a lot of weeks left for work. So I don't have precise plans for the stream. You know, it could be the next Sunday. We will see again. It really depends if I have something interesting to show or not. So it really comes down to that. So thank you very much for joining me, and enjoy 1.7. Of course, you know, you can look forward for updates for the entire next week. We will try to fix all those little things that are still broken. Things like, you know, smoke left in the air if somebody is disconnecting from the server or things like that. So thank you very much, guys. See you next time. Ciao.